The following message is a production of Tony Broom Ministries.
The message of the cross, one of the greatest things that you could ever talk about, the cross of Jesus Christ. Praise God for the old rugged cross. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it one day for a crown. I'll cherish the old rugged cross. Thank God for the cross. The message of the cross has proven to be the salvation of so many souls down through the years. And the message of the cross is our salvation that has brought life to us. Thank God for the cross. We are not ashamed of the cross. And the time that we get ashamed of the cross is the time that we lose the power. And only we'll have is a religion, not salvation. Salvation is based on the cross. Our scriptures, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18 through chapter 2, verse 16. Takes us through chapter 2. And Bible focus is chapter 1, verse 18. The preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. But unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. So you have one message, the preaching of the cross. And it affects two groups. You have two different results. One group, those who are perishing, it is foolishness to talk about a cross, somebody dying on the cross over 2,000 years ago. To them, it's just foolishness. Doesn't mean anything. But to us who are saved, it's the power of God. The greatest thing you could talk about is the cross. It's the same message. It's according on what side of the fence you're on as to how it affects you, what it means to you. Some people taste of something, they say, oh, that tastes bad. Other people taste something, they say, oh, that tastes good. Just like me. I don't like cheese, and everybody else in the world loves it. So, same thing about strawberries. I don't like strawberries. Everybody else loves strawberries. Oh, it's wonderful to them. The two thieves on the cross. One said, if you're who you say you are, save yourself and us too. And the other says, Lord, remember me when you come to your kingdom. The same Lord in the middle cross, but it's the response, your reaction to him. What do we want to accomplish for this lesson? A lesson objective? To reflect on the message of the cross and embrace its centrality to the Christian faith. The cross, the message of the cross, not just the emblem of the cross, not just the cross you hang around your neck, not even just the cross outside Jerusalem, but it's the message of the cross. What happened on that cross? Who was on that cross? And what he did on that cross for us. That's what's important. The message of the cross and embrace its centrality to the Christian faith. It's central. It's the nucleus of the Christian faith. Our central truth, the message of the cross is the foundation of the Christian faith. That's what we stand on, the message of the cross and the blood of his cross. Thank God for the blood. The blood that he shed on the old rugged cross for our sins. Evangelism emphasis. When the message of the cross is clearly proclaimed, sinners can be saved. We have to preach and teach the message of the cross, and we have to do it plainly, clearly, so people can understand. It's not complicated. You take the Gospel of John. When people study New Testament Greek, that's what they usually read is the Gospel of John because it's the most simple form. God is just telling us in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. He made all things, nothing was made without him. And the message of the cross is simple. The preaching of the cross is to them who perish foolishness, but to us which are saved, it is the power of God. First section, declaring God's wisdom and power. This is chapter 1, verse 18 through 31, the end of chapter 1. And it's talking about the wisdom of God and the power of God. The world has its wisdom. They're proclaiming its own wisdom, but God's wisdom is the only one that really is wisdom. All the other wisdom and the prudence, wise counsel of this world, it's just foolishness. They think they're wise. They think they're educated. And this society thinks that we can just educate people and just show them what the problem is. All we need is just another program, another education avenue. We can just educate people enough. No matter how much you educate people, they still, if the heart is not changed, they're still sinners at heart. We're still sinners at heart. The difference between an educated sinner and an uneducated sinner is just education. It's still a sinner. Without Christ, you're still lost. It doesn't matter whether you're a pauper or whether you're a millionaire, whether you're someone who is illiterate, whether you're someone who is highly educated. Education doesn't save you. It might make you smarter in this world, give you wisdom in the world, but the world's wisdom is foolishness in the sight of God. Wisdom is great with God behind it and back of it. The foundation, godly wisdom, is wonderful. But the wisdom of the world is foolishness. The preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. But unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. The preaching of the cross is either foolishness or it's the power of God, according on which group you identify with. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. And he asks a few questions. God is simply saying, where are those people who think they're so smart? Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? In other words, where are all those people that think they're so smart? Hath not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? And he has. The answer to that question is yes. God has made foolish the wisdom of this world because his salvation and the message of the cross does not depend on the wisdom of this world. It depends on the power of God. For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. So the world, even though they thought they were wise and they had their own wisdom, after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. By their own wisdom, they didn't know God. Even though God was the one who had given all wisdom, they turned it unto their own way. And that's why you have what you call worldly wisdom. All wisdom comes from God, but this world has deviated from what God's plan is. And they've made their own way, and they're wise in their own conceits, and they've made their own wisdom. And the wisdom of the world is not the same as the wisdom of God, because the world depends on their self, whereas God, they don't depend on the power of God, and God is the one who declares all things to be righteous or unrighteous. The world did not know God, even though they had wisdom. The world by wisdom knew not God, and it pleased God by the foolishness of preaching. Not foolish preaching now, but by the foolishness of preaching. There's a difference. There's some preaching that you hear, and it is foolish. If you preach that Jesus was not born of a virgin, it's foolish preaching. If you preach the cross does not matter anymore, it's foolish preaching. If you preach that there are many ways to heaven, that's foolish preaching. So he doesn't save people by foolish preaching. He saves people by the foolishness of preaching. Well, what is the foolishness of preaching? Some people think it's foolish to even have any preaching. Why do you need to preach? Why do you need to teach? Why do you need to talk about someone who died on the cross all these years ago? It's because without this, there's no salvation. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. There's no other way to be saved but by the preaching of the gospel. And he tells the disciples, he tells all of us, go into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature. It pleased God. Why do we need preaching? Because this is what pleases God. This is what pleased God to save those who believe. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them who believe. For the Jews require a sign, and the Greeks seek after wisdom. This is what the two groups that Paul was dealing with, the Jew and the Gentile. the Greek and the Jew. The Jew seeks after a sign. They want to be proven to. They were always asking Jesus about this. Prove to us that you're the Messiah. They wanted all these signs. And the Greeks were on a different plane. They wanted everything by wisdom. They approached everything from an intellectual perspective. Things had to match up intellectually. And sometimes things don't match up intellectually, because we're not saved by intellect. It's not by power or by might, but by my spirit, says the Lord. It's not by what the brain thinks all the time, because the brain continually thinks different things. And man's ideas and opinions are different from what God says in His Word. So it's not according to what man thinks or says. It's according to what God's Word says. Man has his ideas, but the ideas of man, the intellect of man, does not save. The Jews require a sign. The Greeks seek after wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, unto the Jews a stumbling block, and unto the Greeks foolishness. But unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. So if you're saved, He is the wisdom of God. He is the power of God. We preach the same message to everyone. And that's important, because we don't need to change the message according to what group you're talking to. Now, I know we can change the method a little bit. You're preaching to children or you're preaching to older people, you might change the method a little bit. But we don't need to change the message. It's the same message, whether you're dealing with Jew, Gentile, red, yellow, black, and white. And it's the same message. We, even though some of them are seeking after signs, some of them are seeking for wisdom, we preach Christ crucified, unto the Jews a stumbling block, and unto the Greeks foolishness. The Jews are stumbling over the stumbling stone. Christ has made a stumbling stone unto them. The Greeks, the Gentiles, is foolishness to them. They cannot see how in the world somebody dying on the cross all those years ago can save people. And that's the only way people can be saved. Unto them who are called, that's that calling that He, same word, ecclesia, He calls us out of the world. Those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men. If there is such a thing as the foolishness of God, and He gives us this just for our understanding. So this is the way that we think. And He helps us by talking in our language. The foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. If there's such thing as a weakness in God, which there's not, but the weakness of God would be still stronger than men. For you see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. Just look at your calling. That same word calling is not like calling to teach or preach necessarily, but all of us have a calling. We're called out of darkness into His marvelous light. And He says, take a look at your calling. Not many wise, not many noble, not many mighty are called. But God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. And God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty, and base things, low things that don't mean anything to a lot of people. Things that are despised hath God chosen, yea, and things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are, that no flesh should glory in His presence. God doesn't work on the same plane that we do. Because if He did, He would be working from a natural standpoint. God doesn't work from a natural standpoint. He works from a spiritual plane. Supernatural. God is supernatural, and that's the plane that He works from. He has chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. The world, in general, they don't know what it means to just come to church. Why would you come to church? Serve a God you've never seen. Give Him your money. Why in the world would you do all this? They don't understand. And we were, in our life, we had times that we didn't understand either. But now you know what it's all about. And you're still learning. And you're still worshiping God. Why does God take the foolish things of the world to confound the wise? And why does he use things that are nothing to show his power and his glory? So that no flesh would glory in his presence. We don't have anything to glory about except the message of the cross. And the song said, I will glory in the cross. I will weep no more for the cross that you bore, but I will glory in the cross. But of him are ye in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. Christ means all these things to us, that according as it is written, he that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord. If we have anything to glory or brag about, we can brag about Jesus. That's the only thing that we need to brag and boast about. Second part, basis for faith in Christ. This is the basis for our faith in Christ. The cross, the old rugged cross. I'll exchange the cross for a crown. We love the cross. We embrace the cross. We cling to the cross because it's there at the cross where I first saw the light and the burdens of my soul were rolled away. Thank God for the old rugged cross, our basis for faith in Christ. And I, brethren, when I came to you, says the Apostle Paul, came not with excellency of speech or of wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. I was determined to focus on the message of the cross. Of all the things that we could talk about, and all the things that we do talk about sometimes, there's nothing so important as the centrality of the message of the cross. I determined not to know anything among you except Christ and him crucified. I wanted to make sure that this is the zero in message that we're talking about. Zero in on the cross. Know nothing else among you. I didn't come to know your business. I didn't come to try to tell you what to do financially. I came to know nothing among you except Christ and him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. Paul didn't come to them as one who had it all together. Just like we don't have it all together sometimes. We do the best we can. But God is the one who makes up the difference. Jesus makes the difference. Paul said, I came to you not perfect, not having it all figured out. I came to you in weakness and in fear. I came in much trembling. I came in nothing in myself. That's why God doesn't wait till we're perfect before he uses us. Some people are sitting back. And they're not being used because they say, well, I'm just not there yet. I'm not good enough yet. None of us are good enough. We have to allow God to use us anyway. If you wait until you're not disabled, you may not ever get used. If you wait till you're not blind, if you wait till whatever, you may not ever get used. God wants to use us as we are, and he's able to make us better. He's able to make wonderful people out of us and things that we cannot even believe God can do in our life. He can take us and use us. My speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power. Paul could have spoken to them eloquently. He had education. He spoke several languages. He could have come to them in all these flowery words, but that's not what he wanted to be. I did not base my message on that. I did not come to you with excellency of speech. I came to you in the power of the Holy Ghost, the demonstration of the power of the Lord, not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Howbeit we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, those who are complete, those who are in Christ, yet not the wisdom of this world, nor of the princes of this world that come to naught. The King James uses the word naught. It's nothing. The wisdom of this world, princes of this world, they come to nothing. They think they got it all together. They come up with this program. They come up with this thing. You just put me in office and I'll do so and so. You won't do anything more than the last one did. You won't do anything more than the news media lets you do most of the time. And that's not very much. When I get up there, I'll let you know. They got up there and they hadn't let me know anything yet. the wisdom of this world, the princes of this world, they come to nothing. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory. This is the wisdom that God has given, that He ordained before the world even was, unto our glory. God had this thing planned out, and this wisdom that we now have, godly wisdom. You have wisdom that you think you don't have. You have enough wisdom to turn away from evil and serve Jesus. That's wisdom. You have enough wisdom to love God. And that's what He's talking about. We speak this wisdom of God in a mystery. It's a mystery to many people. Even the hidden wisdom which God before ordained unto our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew. The princes, the people of this world, none of them knew. For had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. If they had known this wonderful love and wisdom that we enjoy now, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But then the scripture could not have been fulfilled, and God's word, of course, would be fulfilled, but people still have a choice. And if they would have known this wonderful wisdom of God, they would never have crucified the Lord of glory. They didn't realize who He was. And some of them knew that He was the Messiah and refused to receive Him. But that was because they had the wisdom of the world and not the wisdom of God. Revealed by God's Spirit. And we're talking about the Spirit of God revealing the things of God to us as the people of God. Verses 9 through 16. But as it is written, eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love Him. We cannot even fathom the wonderful things that God has. And it says it here, eye has not seen nor ear heard the things that God has prepared for them who love Him. But it doesn't stop there. Yes, it's true. We don't know all about it. But we do know a lot about it because God has revealed them unto us by His Spirit. For the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. For what man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of man which is in him? The little spirit that's in us, they know the things of us because the Spirit is in us, our spirit. The spirit of man which is in him, he knows the things of man. Even so, the things of God knoweth no man but the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God knows the things of God because He is God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God, which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. This is a spiritual thing. The message of the cross is not just a factual thing. It is fact. Jesus died on the cross and rose again. But it's not just a factual thing. It's a spiritual thing. It's a thing that is dealing with the soul of man, with the spirit. And you have to have the Spirit of God in order to understand the things of God. The Spirit of God compares spiritual things with spiritual. But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him, neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. The natural mind, the natural man, cannot comprehend the things of the Spirit of God. They are foolishness to him, neither can he know them. And the Scripture says in Romans chapter 8 that the carnal mind is enmity against God. It's not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. We have to have our mind and our heart changed by the Spirit of God. He that is spiritual judgeth all things, yet he himself is judged of no man. I thought Scripture says, do not judge. Judge not that you be not judged. Well, it says don't judge people. It says here that he that is spiritual judges all things, not people. You judge things. You have to make judgments in this world to know what's right and wrong. That's why people are not knowing what's right and wrong. They're just drifting along with the tumbling tumbleweed. They're not making judgments. You have to make judgments in life to know what's right and wrong. You have to make judgments and say, I'm not going back there anymore. I'm not doing that anymore. If he thinks I'm going back there after they treat you crazy, you have to make judgments. If you go in a raw business deal, somebody does you wrong, you say, I'm not going back there anymore. I'm going to do so and so. And God gives you direction to do better. All of us make wise judgments. We have to make judgments in this life. We don't judge people. But he says right here, he who is spiritual judges all things, yet he himself is judged of no man. You conduct yourself in such a way that people don't have to judge you because you're making righteous judgments, righteous decisions, and you're conducting your life under the leadership of the Holy Spirit in the way that God would have you to. For who hath known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. We're not instructing him, he's instructing us. He's telling us what to do. And the message of the cross then is the same for every generation. Doesn't matter whether it's a New Age generation or whether it's a generation that has been since we have been or even before us. The message of the cross is still the same. Jesus died on the old rugged cross. I am thine, O Lord. I have heard thy voice, and it spoke love to me. The message of the cross still rings out. Draw me nearer, 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 precious Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. The message of the cross still rings out true and still rings out to the world. This is a salvation that God provides. Whosoever will may come and take the water of life freely. And the message of the cross is still the same. Jesus still offers eternal life to all those who believe. God sent his Son into the world. Whosoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. Heavenly Father, thank you for such a wonderful word. Thank you that the message of the cross is not complicated. Thank you, Lord, that you have provided a way that everyone can be saved. Doesn't matter whether a person cannot read or write. Doesn't matter whether we don't have any money. But the message of the cross can reach our heart, can touch our soul, and can save us from a devil's hell. I pray, Lord, today that many would come to you at the foot of the cross. Bow as the same that we did, coming to Jesus as Savior and making him their Lord. And I pray that many would be born again in Jesus' name. Amen.
The preceding message has been a production of Tony Broom Ministries.